Hellfire. My brothers, let's talk about our body. When certain parts of our body are connected to Allah in His remembrance, then by nature, our actions will follow suit. By nature, our heart has something, a feeling. And that feeling I want to talk about today is the love and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, one of the most easiest things to cause you to fall into a mistake is to say something. Kalima. One word. Once words come out, they don't come back in. Once you said it, it was wrong. You have to make a istighfar, you have to make tawbah. You're smacking yourself on the head, you're like, ah, I wish I wouldn't have said that. Today I want to talk about an athar, a narration. This narration is on Ar-Rabee ibn Khuthaym. كان يقول لا خير في الكلام إلا في تسع تحميد الله وتكبير الله وتسبيح الله وتحليل الله وأمرك بالمعروف ونهيك عن المنكر وسؤالك الخير وتعوذك من الشر وقراءة القرآن. الربيع ابن خثيم, he said, the best speech on the tongue is found in 9 words. 9 words. Choose one of these 9 that I'm about to mention and regularly practice them on your tongue, wherever you are. He said, the best speech on the tongue is found in 9 words. The first, Alhamdulillah. The second, Allahu Akbar, which is the takbir. The third, saying Subhanallah. The fourth, La ilaha illallah. The fifth, commanding good and preventing evil. The next one, seeking refuge from evil. And the last, but not least, the best dhikr on the tongue, he said, was what? Reading the Quran. So, we connect our tongue. We keep our tongues moist and wet with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's talk about some benefits of this subject. First, Alhamdulillah. You know, this is the first praise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us in the Quran. Allah praises Himself. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. I can't praise myself. I cannot come forward and say, praise me. I'm not worthy of praise. Well, like in Allah said, Alhamdulillah. Right? Because He is deserving of praise. Why? Look at His majesty. Look at what He has created. Look at what He owns. Allah owns everything. So, Alhamdulillah, this is the first praise the Muslims are taught in the Quran in Surah Al-Fatiha. Allah informs us that He deserves praises. So what? He teaches us to praise Him. Alhamdulillah, what it means is that we offer thanks to Allah for the blessings He has given us. Before we eat, we say, Bismillah, right? But what happens after we eat? We say what? Alhamdulillah. You ate a good meal. After you finish your drink, you say what? Alhamdulillah. When all khair comes to you, you say what? Alhamdulillah. Because it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has given you this blessing. Alhamdulillah, we are in Jummah today. Alhamdulillah, we have sight. We have hearing. Alhamdulillah, all praises belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessings He has given us. And you know, Alhamdulillah, offering praises to Allah, although it includes showing gratitude, showing thanks, it is more comprehensive. It is more detailed. Okay? It is more detailed. For example, I can say thank you Muhammad. I can say, thank you, Ibrahim, for doing something for me. But this isn't necessarily a praise. But when we say Alhamdulillah, we thank Allah and we praise Allah. The next one is Allahu Akbar. Do we really think and contemplate on the meaning of Allahu Akbar? Just the fact alone that it is what enters us into salah. What does Allahu Akbar mean? Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said saying Allahu Akbar means Allah is greater than everything that exists. This is why Muhammad Ali rahimahullah, he stopped saying I'm the greatest. He stopped saying that because Allah humbled him. You know, Muhammad Ali rahimahullah, he's African American Muslim from the early 60s. And died upon Sunni Islam. He was known as one of the greatest boxers. Greatest boxers. But he stopped saying I was the greatest because Allah sent a disease to him which eventually caused his death. Parkinson's. So Allahu Akbar. When we call the event, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. We're calling you to recognize that you need to worship Allah because He is the greatest of everything that exists. So this is what Allahu Akbar means. Everything that exists. There's nothing greater than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these words, they are a pillar of the prayer. No prayer can begin without saying them. However, outside of the prayer, we still must acknowledge that it is Allah who is greater than any and everything that we know of. For example, I might say, Muhammad, he is Hakim. Walakin Allah Ahkam. We say he is wise, he's fair. Muhammad wa rajulun adil. Walakin Allah Adil. We might say, Sheikh Fulan, Fulan. Innahu al-Karam, huwa Kareem, walakin Allah akramu. Allah is more generous. So understand the elitist case here. Allah a'lam. This is what we say when someone asks you something and you don't know. Shaykh Fulan huwa a'lam, walakin Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a'lam. Allah a'lamu minhu. Allah is greater than everything that exists and so forth. Subhanallah. Subhanallah, my brothers and sisters. This means that Allah is far from all perfections. I have deficiencies. You have deficiencies. None of us are free from imperfections except Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why we say subhanallah. You know, when you see something that amazes you, what can come to your mind? Subhanallah. When something astonishes you, subhanallah. But when we say subhanallah, this word, it removes all of the defects, all of the shortcomings from Allah's names and attributes. It removes all of the defects from Allah's names and attributes. Or even, to take it a step further when we say subhanallah, we don't attribute to Allah that which He hasn't attributed to Himself. We don't attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that which He has attributed to Himself in His names or in His attributes. You understand? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of all the worlds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of everything that exists. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the sole judge on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Ali ibn Abi Talib was asked about saying subhanallah. And he said, it extols and magnifies Allah's greatness. أقول قولي هذا سبحانه استغفر الله. الحمد لله. اللهم صلِّ على أجبت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. The next one we come to is لا إله إلا الله. This word is among the most virtuous words that a person can say. In fact, Amr ibn Maymun, in a narration collected in Hilyat al-Awliya, he said it is the greatest thing that a person can say. It's the greatest thing a person can utter. Whereas saying Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar, and Alhamdulillah, and saying La ilaha illallah, we can say these four words. But saying La ilaha illallah, it is the best amongst those. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why did He create mankind in jinn? To worship Him. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send messengers? To enforce La ilaha illallah. Why did He send the Injil? Why did He send the Torah? Why did He send the Zabur? Why did He send the Quran? To teach La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. What makes it superior over the other words? It's the key to Jannah. La ilaha illallah separates you and I from the kufar. La ilaha illallah on our tongues separates us from the kufar, the disbelievers. La ilaha illallah is the rope of Allah. La ilaha illallah is amongst the heaviest things on the scales of the day of judgment, the heaviest thing. La ilaha illallah, kalimatul taqwa, it's the word of taqwa. La ilaha illallah is the shahada, it's the first pillar of Islam. There's five, but what's the first one? Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah is the strongest branch of Iman, and there's 70 some odd branches. La ilaha illallah, if a person says it on the time of his death, and it's the last thing that he said, سَيَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ. La ilaha illallah, مِفْتَاح لِدَارَ السَّعَادَةِ. مِفْتَاح لِلسَّعَادَةِ. It's the key to the Garden of Eden. It's the key to happiness in this world. The next one of La ilaha illallah, my brothers and sisters, is that you must understand what it means. La ilaha, it negates any and everything that is worshipped other than Allah. Illallah, it affirms that worship belongs to Him alone. This is the true meaning of La ilaha illallah. Commanding the good and preventing the evil. This is the second level of commanding what's right and preventing what's wrong. Meaning that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever amongst you sees an evil, then let him change it with his hands. And if he doesn't have the ability to let him change it, how? With his tongue. And this is a hadith collected on Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He said, whoever among you witnesses an evil, then let him change it with his hands. And if he isn't able, then with his tongue. And if he can't change it with his tongue, then let him have it in his heart. And this is the weakness of faith. Changing the evil and commanding the good requires a few things before a person indulges on this. First, the person must be certain the act is incorrect. Are you sure what you're about to speak about is wrong? Are you sure what you're about to say is not correct? It's going against the sunnah. So if a person wants to prevent shirk, if a person wants to prevent bid'ah, if a person wants to prevent kufr, he must be certain that the act the person is doing is shirk, bid'ah, and kufr, or any other deen. Okay? The person must also be certain that the person he's advising is actually committing the act. This is why the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever amongst you sees it, whoever amongst you sees it, not whoever, you know, tells you. No, you enjoin what is right and forbid what is wrong when you see that munkar. When you see that munkar with your own eyes. Okay? Because you might be advising somebody about something that someone else told you, that someone else told them, and you're wrong. That person, he didn't commit the evil. Also, the person preventing the evil must be sure that by doing it will not push the person into a greater evil. It will not push a person into what? A greater evil. Okay? The next one is seek refuge from evil. Yeah. You know the greatest evil that you and I face? I said it today. The evil of our souls. The evils of our whims and desires. In fact, Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, شَرُّ الْإِلَهِ أُبْنِدَ فِي الْأَرْضِ الْهَوَى. The most evil of deities worshipped on the earth is the deity of Hawa. So where does that come from? Us following our desires. What are the two greatest desires in man? Eating and sex. What are the two greatest desires in women? They crave attention. They crave the dunya. This is all from their desires. This is why some scholars say that Hawa, she was the first to eat from the tree, and it wasn't Adam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. But our desires, brother, we should constantly seek refuge against the desires from the evil desires of our soul. Because all desires, okay, when we're hungry, we eat. When we're thirsty, we drink. Okay? But the evil desires that we have inside of our body is what we should seek refuge from. Ibn Qayyim, he says, seeking refuge in Allah and seeking assistance against the evil of the soul and the plots of your enemy is among the greatest ways to attain happiness. And the last one is reading the Quran. The Quran, as many scholars consider, is the best way to remember Allah. It's the best dhikr, the Quran. Abu Salama asked Imam al-Awsa'i, if reading the Quran was superior to dhikr. And you know what he said? He said, ask Abu Muhammad. And this is Sa'id ibn Musayyib. And Sa'id said, the Quran. And then Imam al-Awsa'i said, nothing compares to the Quran. Nothing compares to the Quran. Why? Because it's the speech of Allah. You know, the Quran, one of its superiority is that everything in this dunya is created except the Quran. The Quran is the speech of Allah. It's not created. But everything else is created. This phone is created. This microphone is created. This masjid is created. It was built. But the Quran is the speech of Allah. The Quran, you know, when we read it, it earns us rewards that we can't even imagine. Let's take this for example. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, from Allah's book, whoever recites a letter from Allah's book, then he receives the reward of it, and the reward 10 times similar. He said, I do not say that Alif, Lam, Meen is a letter, but Alif is a letter, Lam is a letter, and Meen is a letter. That's 30 hasana. You know, so that you can conceptualize this better, the Quran is what? 30 parts, right? 114 chapters. Listen to what Ibn Abbas said. Ibn Abbas, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, there are 323,671 letters. Let me say that again. There are 323,671 letters in the Quran. So, mathematically, brothers and sisters, let's add this up. If we complete the Quran one time, min Fatiha ila Nas, you know what that is? 3 million hasanat. Did you catch that? 3 million hasanat. Because it's 323,671 letters. Not words, letters. We get a reward for each letter we read from the Quran. Reading the Quran is the best action for the tongue, and reflecting over its meaning is the best action for the heart, as Al-Allama Abdul Hamid Ibn Badis Al-Jaza'iri Rahimahullah said. My brothers and sisters, choose one thing that I said today and try and make sure that you connect your tongue to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By doing this, we open ourselves up to His mercy. We open ourselves up to His forgiveness. You understand? We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us. Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qulubina ala deenik. Ya musarrif al-qulub, sarrif qulubina ila ta'atik. O changer of the hearts, change our hearts to your religion. O changer of the hearts, allow us to be more obedient. Allahumma inna nas'aluka jannah. Allahumma inna nas'aluka jannah. Allahumma inna nas'aluka jannah. O Allah, we ask you for jannah. O Allah, we ask you for jannah. O Allah, we ask you for jannah. O Allah, save us from the hellfire. O Allah, save us from the hellfire. O Allah, save us from the hellfire.